this is the basic teaching of Jesus about the rapture. And some of the significant things about it that we want to take a look at is, where's the place that he's preparing for us? Where he's going. And that's in heaven. Okay? It's not here on earth. It's in heaven. Okay? Because that's where the Father is. Okay? And he's going back to the Father, and he's saying, my Father's house has many rooms. Some versions say mansions, has many mansions. That's not really what the Greek is. The Greek is just rooms, place, dwelling places is all it is. So if you have your heart set on a Tennessee-style mansion in heaven, we don't need that, okay? it's a dwelling place, and it's going to be wonderful. Okay. Okay, now, that thing that he puts, that where I am, there you may be also. Okay, is this a promise of physical togetherness with Jesus Christ? Is it? Or is it talking about spiritual togetherness, which we have right now, okay, with Jesus Christ? It is talking about physical togetherness. It is actually talking about us being in the presence of Jesus Christ, okay? And we're going to find out very soon that that's what's taught in the rest of the New Testament as well. Okay, 1st, the major teaching, this is probably the major teaching by Paul about the rapture. And 1 Thessalonians 4, 14 through 18. So let's just read it through, and then we'll discuss some of the things that he brings out. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will not precede those who have fallen asleep. And remember, when he's saying fallen asleep, what is he talking about? He's talking about those people that have died. Okay? As far as God is concerned and Jesus is concerned, when we die here on earth, all we've done is we've just fallen asleep. Because the two parts of our person that are eternal, our soul and our spirit, are not going to be affected. It's just this jar of clay that we're in, this flesh. Okay? So they've fallen asleep. The Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ are going to rise first, okay? Then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with him in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we shall always be with the Lord. Other versions is we'll be with the Lord forever, okay? Therefore, comfort one another with these words. So, a very important teaching, and we're going to look at several different aspects of it. First off, let's go back and take a look at what the word rapture means, because you'll get people who come up to you and say, do you know that the word rapture is not even in the Bible? And that's not entirely correct, okay? In the English version of the Bible, it's not there, okay? Because the word that is used in the Greek is harpazo. And harpazo is it's a verb to snatch away, to grab something and to snatch it away. Okay, that's the Greek. The Latin that is used, they had to make up a term in Latin for this particular verb, and that term is rapturos. Okay, and that's where we get the word rapture, okay? So the Latin, it's rapturos, and that's where the name rapture comes from, and that's what we have named this particular action, this the taking away, the snatching away of the saints from the earth. That's why it's called the rapture. In In the English versions, it doesn't say rapture. What it does is it uses the verb to snatch away, and it says, in this case, I think what it says is to be caught up, right? I think that's what it actually says. And we who are alive and remain will be caught up right there. That's that word that is rapture, rapturos, in the Latin, okay? So that's where it comes from. Right, there's a sequence of events in here. They're laid out very succinctly. And what Paul says, okay, the first thing is that the Lord himself will descend from heaven. Okay, he's going to come down from heaven. There's going to be a shout, there's going to be the voice of the archangel, and there's going to be a trumpet, the trumpet of God. Okay? So he descends, there's the shout, and the trumpet, and then the dead and the Christ are going to rise. Okay, that's what happens. And then next, we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with him in the clouds and meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we always be with the Lord. Okay, so that's the sequence of events for the rapture. Another teaching that Paul has on the rapture is from 1 Corinthians. This is, well, let's just read it through, and then we'll go back and talk about it. Now I say this, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will be changed. In the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For this perishable must put on the imperishable, and this mortal must put on immortality. But when this perishable will have put on the imperishable, and this mortal will have put on immortality, then will come about the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, mystery. What does mystery mean? He says, this is the mystery. Behold, I tell you a mystery. And remember, mystery, usually when it's used in the New Testament, it means a couple different things. The first thing it means is it's not something that's talked about in the Old Testament, okay? So if you have a Jewish background, you know everything about the Old Testament. What you know of the Old Testament is not going to tell you what is going on here, okay? And that's one of the things that mystery means, is that it is a teaching that is in the New Testament, okay, and not in the Old. The next thing is that... It can also be something that's difficult for us to understand as humans, okay? What was the next question? Okay, sleep. And we just talked about that. Sleep means those that have died, okay? Those Christians that have died, because they're merely... We don't believe in soul sleep or anything like that. We know from what Paul teaches in another place, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord, okay? So our soul and our spirit, when the body dies, goes to be with the Lord and is with the Lord, and that's why when he comes back, he brings those souls with him and gives them a new body there when everybody else is, just before we are given our new bodies as well. Okay. Okay, how quick will our change be? What did he say? When we put on the incorruptible, when we get our new resurrected bodies, how long is it going to take? And a lot of people say, well, that's the winking of an eye. It's not the winking of an eye, it's the twinkling of an eye. And from what I understand, the twinkling of the eye is the time it takes light to get from the lens of your eye to the retina of your eye and then back and reflect back to the lens of your eye as a twinkle. And so we're talking like 0.00001 of a second. I mean, it's instantaneous, okay? And we're going to be putting on the incorruptible and imperishable. That means that the bodies that we are going to be receiving are not going to be subject to decay and death, okay? And most theologians believe that what that means is sin. Sin has brought about this condition that we have, because when Adam was first originally created, he was not created to die. And it's sin that came into the world when Adam rebelled, of course, that corrupted our bodies so that they now decay almost from the time that we're born. Our bodies are decaying and dying. And that is no longer going to be the case. Okay. Now the next question is, what is the last trumpet? And this is the controversial question in this particular passage. Because it says, at the last trumpet. And if you study eschatology very much, you find out that there are quite a few trumpets in eschatology in quite a few different places. And so there's a lot of different beliefs about when that trumpet is going to be and which trumpet that is. I personally believe it doesn't matter, because I think what happens is he comes down with a bunch of angels, they have trumpets, and they all play, and the very last one is the last trumpet, okay? And that's when it's going to happen. One of the problems that we have is that in Matthew, and we're going to look at that here very shortly, in Matthew 24, 29, what does Jesus say that it's going to be like a thief in the night? He doesn't even know the time that it's going to be, okay? And if we start saying that, well, this is the last trumpet when Jesus returns, do we know when Jesus is going to return? Well, actually, if you look in eschatology, there's times and there's dates, things that are set up. We will know the timing at least 7 years in advance of when Jesus is going to return and put his feet on the ground. For the rapture, though, he has told us that we aren't going to know. It's going to be like a thief in the night. It's going to be a surprise. Okay? So that changes the way we think about the trumpet. And I just want to bring those things into your mind, because we'll see later on, especially probably next week when we go into the different views of when the rapture is going to take place, that trumpet looms large, okay, in people's beliefs. Let's go on to 2 Thessalonians. And this is actually probably one of the most important teachings that we're going to talk about today, and so we're going to spend a little bit of time on it. Now we request you, brethren, with regard to the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together of him, that you do not be quickly shaken from your composure or be disturbed either by a spirit or a message or a letter, as if it's from us, to the effect that the day of the Lord has come. Okay, it seems like one thing about the Thessalonians that you need to understand, I'm just going to explain this, is that the Thessalonians is the Thessalonian church is a church that has no Jews in it. When Paul got to Thessalonica, that's up in Thessaly, up in the northern part of Greece, there were no Jews in the area, because he usually goes to the Jews first and to their synagogue, and then he goes and to the people. He had to go directly to the people because there weren't any Jews in the area. Now, the Jews followed him there, and they made trouble. Okay, in fact, he wound up in jail there. Remember, this is the church where, what was it? It was the, I may be thinking of Philippi, actually. But anyway, this church does not have Jews in it. And so all the teaching that they got about the things, the day of the Lord, which is a teaching from the Old Testament about the end times, okay, that had to come to them from Paul himself. But there were other people that followed Paul there to teach, Christians to teach, and they said the day of the Lord was happening. So he is trying to settle them down because they thought if the day of the Lord is happening that they had missed the rapture. Okay? And so he's trying to show them, no, that hasn't happened. This is the sequence of events. This is the way things are going to work. Okay. Let no one in any way deceive you, for it will not come unless the apostasy comes first and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the son of destruction who opposes and exalts himself above every so-called God or object of worship, so that he takes his seat in the temple of God, displaying himself as being God. Okay, this is the man of lawlessness. It's another name for the Antichrist. Okay, and we know about him from Daniel. Okay, we know that he is going to be the major player in the end times. Do you not remember that while I was still with you, I was telling you of these things? I want to get videos of those meetings because it would explain so much to us, I think. And you know that what restrains him now, so that in this time he will be revealed, for the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he is taken out of the way. And then that lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will slay with the breath of his mouth and bring to an end by the appearance of his coming. Okay, so we've got a sequence of events that he gives. Okay, and he doesn't specifically say where the rapture is going to be in the sequence of events, but he gives us some hints. Okay, that is the one who is coming in accord with the activity of Satan, with all the power and the signs and false wonders, which is an interesting word that's stuck in there, and with all deception of the wickedness for those who perish, because they... Okay, and with all the deception of wickedness for those who perish, because they did not receive the love of the truth as to be saved. For this reason, God will send upon them a deluding influence so that they will believe what is false in order that they may be judged, who did not believe the truth, but took pleasure in wickedness. Lots of things going on there. The very first thing I want to explain, basically, is what the day of the Lord is, what they're talking about, and why these Thessalonians were so upset when they were told that they were in the day of the Lord. And this goes back to our first lesson on Daniel's 70 weeks. And remember, the first 69 weeks went up to the ministry of Jesus Christ. And then after that, there is a prophetic gap because Jerusalem gets destroyed. The temple gets destroyed. Jerusalem is no longer there. And we know that in that 70th week of years, which is 70 years long, of course, okay, that last is going to be at the very end of this age. Okay? And it culminates, the very end of it culminates with Jesus Christ coming again and putting his feet on the Mount of Olives and taking over the world as the King of the world. Okay? That's the end, at the very end of that 70th week. That's the last 7 years. That is the day of the Lord. Now, there's a lot going on in the day of the Lord that we're going to talk about. But the thing that you need to understand about it, it's not a nice time, okay? In fact, the day of the Lord, the way it's taught in the Old Testament, we're going to see that in 2 weeks. We're going to talk about the day of the Lord. It's a time of destruction. It's a time that God's wrath is poured out onto an unbelieving world, okay? And there's an incredible amount of destruction. And some of that destruction is caused by the people that are warring against Israel and warring against the saints, okay? The saints are going to be hunted, and Jews are going to be, they're going to have their own nation at that time. We know that they're going to have their own nation. They're going to have, in fact, we know that not only is there going to be a nation of Israel, we know that there is also going to be, the capital of Israel is going to be Jerusalem. And we know that in the capital of Israel, there is going, in Jerusalem, there is going to be a temple. Now, some of those things have happened already in our lifetimes. We're very close, okay? But there's a couple of them that haven't yet. Well, the temple's not there yet, okay? But that's all happening. And then the beginning of that time is when the man of lawlessness, the Antichrist, signs the treaty with Israel, right? He signs the treaty with Israel for 7 years, okay? And then we know that the midpoint of it is when he breaks that treaty and he goes into the temple and he announces himself as God and says everybody is to worship him, okay? That's the midpoint, okay? But all of this time is a time where God is dealing with the unbelief of the world, okay? And it's a time of wrath of God. And we'll read about that and talk about it when we get to Revelation, because he really puts it out, all the different judgments that God brings forth on the world. So that is the day of the Lord. Okay, that is what the day of the Lord is. And so they're thinking that they're already there in that time period. And Paul is telling them, no, there's several things that have to happen first. Okay? So the very first thing that he talks about is the apostasy. Okay? The apostasy. And that's up here. Okay. The fact that the Lord is, no one in any way should deceive you, for it will not come unless the apostasy comes first. This is a very interesting term. It's the Greek term apostasia, which we have the word apostasy from. But what it means is a falling away, okay? To fall away from the straight, but it's a falling away is what it is. Some theologians, and I've heard it taught actually several times, and some very good theologians too, believe that this is the rapture. Okay, that is the Christians being falling away from the world. And that's what they're talking about. I personally do not believe that. Okay, I personally believe that the apostasy is a falling away of the church from Christ. Okay, and it's something I think that we can see in the world today. When we look around us, there's lots of different churches that are not preaching the gospel of God, the gospel of Christ. Christ crucified, and if you don't understand that gospel, Jesus Christ being crucified and rising again as a savior for our sins, okay, being the sacrifice, if you don't believe in that, you are not a Christian, okay? And there's a lot of churches out there that have become social clubs, and they teach a lot of good moral things, but they're not centering on the gospel of Christ. And so other things have crept into those churches today, and they are leading the people of those churches away from Christ. Okay, and I think that that's what the great apostasy is. There's also coming, in order for a one-world government to come about, which we know is what the man of lawlessness has, he is going to be the leader of the whole world, okay, besides Israel. In order to have that, you are going to have to bring all these peoples of different faiths together, okay? And to minimize the amount of rebellion and everything, it's best to have a teaching, a great teaching that will bring all these religions together in the same belief, okay? And I think that may also be the great apostasy, and we can see that happening now as well. So the apostasy comes first, even before the man comes on the scene. The apostasy has to happen. Okay. Now the man of lawlessness is going to be revealed, but he tells us later on that there is a restrainer, and you know what restrains him now, so in his time he will be revealed. For this mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he is taken out of the way. So the question comes up is, who or what is the restrainer? Okay? Because the restrainer has to be taken out of the way before the Antichrist is actually revealed. Most theologians who look at this closely will say that the restrainer is or has to do very much with the Holy Spirit. Okay? That the Holy Spirit here on earth is restraining evil in this world around us. Okay? And he is going to be, that mission of his that he is involved in right now, he is going to be pulled away from at some point by God. Well, he is God. Okay, that decision is going to be made when that is. He will stop restraining, and everything is going to happen quickly. Other people believe, yes, it's the Holy Spirit, but it's the Holy Spirit at work through the church, the true church. And what this comes down to is Christians like us praying about their country, about the things that they see are wrong, about the world, about everything that's going on in the world, okay? We pray, the Holy Spirit works. The power of prayer is real, okay? And that's what many people believe. In fact, I tend to believe this as well, that the restrainer is the Holy Spirit at work through the local church, through the church. The more we pray, the more he restrains. So, when that restrainer is taken out of the way, is it because the church stops praying? I think it's probably because the church is gone. The church is taken out of the world, okay? And that's when the rapture is. That's what I personally believe, that the restrainer is working through the church and the power of prayer in the church, and that as soon as we are taken out of this world, we are going to be somewhat distracted when we get to heaven, okay? We're going to be in the presence of Jesus Christ. We're not going to be thinking about what's going on down here on earth, okay? So we've got these things. The restrainer has to be taken out of the way, and then after the restrainer is taken out of the way, then the lawless one, the Antichrist, is going to be revealed. So should we try to pick who is the Antichrist at this point in time? He hasn't been revealed yet. We don't know who he is. And it's really pointless to point fingers, okay? He isn't going to be revealed until the restrainer is taken out of the way. Now, the Antichrist uses power and false wonders, okay? The interesting word in here, I think, is false. We know that he is going to have some kind of power that is given to him by Satan, that he is going to be doing miraculous things. Now, the interesting thing is it says false, okay? And I wonder how much video magic is being used at this time in order to make people, to deceive people, to think that these things are miraculous. So the word false is in there. Okay, what else do we need to talk about here? Okay, the two things that have to happen before the day of the Lord is to start is that the man of lawlessness is the apostasy. Actually, there's three. The apostasy, the restrainer is taken out of the way, and then the man of lawlessness is revealed. All three of those things have to be there before the day of the Lord even starts, because what happens, what's the very beginning of the day of the Lord? It is a treaty between Israel and the Antichrist. So we know that the Antichrist has to be on the scene. Okay. The other interesting thing at the very end of this is he's talking about God and God's role in the end times, part of it. Okay. The people that don't believe in God, why are they not believing in God? I mean, they've all been given a chance. The gospel has been spread around the world. It is everywhere. It's on the internet. It's not that difficult to find right now. But when it comes time, okay, for the rapture to happen, everybody will have had a chance to see and to make a decision. And the reason it says that they don't choose Jesus Christ is because they don't have the love of the truth. Okay? They are deceived to the point where they do not understand or see or care about the truth. And I think we can see that today, and actually in our society in a lot of ways. And the interesting thing is that God is going to send upon them a deluding influence, so they're going to believe what's false. He says, okay, if you're not going to believe in me and the truth, even though you've been given all this evidence, okay, if you're not going to believe in me, and actually if you take a look at the evidence is there today in science and all kinds of, everything is pointing to God. But that's a whole lesson in and of itself. But so he says, God says, if you're not going to be believing in me, if you've made this decision to believe in what is false and not believe in the truth, then he's going to send them a deluding influence so that they're going to be going that way altogether. Okay? You go ahead and you do what is false, so they believe what is false in order that they may all be judged, okay, because they do not believe in the truth, but they take pleasure in wickedness. And a lot of people don't believe in the truth because they take pleasure in their sin. Okay? So it's going to, in this time, in the day of the Lord, God is going to be pushing them along the way. He's going to be using his influence, okay, to get them to go and to do the things that they want to do, because that's going to bring about the situation that he wants to happen. That being said, let's remember that God has already told us that he wants all to come to the knowledge of Christ. There's no question about that. He wants all to come to the knowledge of Christ. But he also knows that there are those people that are going to hate the truth, okay? They're going to turn away from the truth, and they are going to go their own way because of they love sin and they love wickedness, okay? Yes? Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They don't just get a deluding influence, but they will be judged. Mm-hmm. They're going to be judged, though, mm-hmm. They don't.
And I don't believe that. Okay. I believe that there's going to be a lot of people that are going to see Christians, and they're not going to make a decision for Christ for various different reasons. But when the rapture happens, when the church is taken out of this world, they're going to say, oops, we missed, we were wrong, let's go back and study. The Bible's still going to be there. And we know